Hello and welcome to the online service from Nambour Anglican Parish, Southeast Queensland, Australia. My name is Ralph Bowles. I'm the priest in charge of this parish in the Anglican Church, Southern Queensland. This service is a brief explanation of the Christian gospel, a brief act of worship, and we pray that in listening to it and watching it, you will find encouragement in your search for God, if you're searching for God, or in your relationship with God, if you want to express faith and hope. Here is a verse from the Apostle John to open our service today. From 1 John chapter 1. This is the message we have heard from him and declare to you, God is light, in him there is no darkness at all. May God bless you today as you join your spirit with God's spirit in worship and fellowship. Billions of people recently, of course, watched the funeral of Her Majesty the late Queen Elizabeth. And what we saw there at one point, of course, was the imperial crown of the monarch of Great Britain. And it was her crown, and it was placed upon her casket and ferried with her body, with the casket, to the place of her burial. It was a great symbol, of course, that jeweled crown, priceless in its worth, a priceless treasure. Well, I would like to talk to you today about a treasure of far greater value that needs to be guarded. We all know about how the crown jewels are guarded in the Tower of London and the security needed on them. Well, here is a message that I'd like to bring you about from 2 Timothy about a great treasure that the church has been given to guard. So Paul says to his younger colleague Timothy, he says, guard the good deposit that was entrusted to you. Guard it with the help of the Holy Spirit who lives in us. I'm beginning today as following our lectionary with a series of sermons on 2 Timothy, the little letter of 2 Timothy. And it's a wonderful letter. Here this letter is, if you like, Paul's final letter in the New Testament. The aged apostle facing his trial, and we know from history that he was executed, and handing on the baton, if you like, or writing to encourage a younger colleague to whom he was leaving so much of the apostolic work. And he knew that Timothy was a man of different character to himself. The impression we get from St. Paul is that a fairly indomitable character, brilliant, strong-minded, inflexible, a large heart, caring for people who prepared to face anything for his mission to the Gentiles. And Timothy, however, who was in charge, I think, of the church of Ephesus at this time, a man of much younger years and therefore often not treated seriously, a person perhaps of timid disposition, maybe had a nervous stomach, we don't know, but he needed encouragement. And sometimes the challenges of ourselves as Christians can be very daunting. We can lack confidence facing opposition or false teaching. Think about that first generation of Christians. Not large in number, they had no big buildings, no status in society. And quite soon, early on in the New Testament days, they were at odds with other movements and even the government. So what will they need? What will people like Timothy need in terms of personal resources and encouragement to face it? Paul gives an exhortation to Timothy in the first chapter. This is the theme for my message today. For this reason, he says, I remind you to fan into flame the gift of God, which is in you through the laying on of my hands. For the Spirit God gave us does not make us timid, but gives us power, love, and self-discipline. Or as it's often translated, power, love, and a sound mind. Power, love, and a sound mind. So let's look at this magnificent encouragement of St. Paul. And, you know, we might think that if people were had given the aged apostle trouble, then they would eat Timothy for breakfast. So he needed encouragement. Now, Paul, in this opening chapter of the Gospel, and our reading does go from 2 Timothy 1 largely down to the end of the chapter, make it chapter 1 for convenience sake, he gives four encouraging reasons why Timothy and his colleagues should guard the Gospel of God. Why is it so valuable? You know, we all have things that are valuable, sometimes mementos, sometimes possessions. Hopefully our people that we love are valuable and we'll protect them above everything. So what is the value of this gospel, this good news? What makes it so worth treasuring? Well, he says here, the good news, of course, is a treasure worth preserving and handing on. This is in verses 8 to 11. And why is it such a valuable message? Well, it's a message about salvation. He says there in verse 8, join with me in suffering for gospel by the grace of God, by the power of God. He has saved us and called us to a holy life, not because of anything we have done, but because of his own purpose and grace. This grace was given us in Christ Jesus before the beginning of time, but it has now been revealed through the appearing of our Saviour, Christ Jesus, who has destroyed death and has brought life and immortality to light through the gospel. It's a message of salvation by grace. It's a message of our rescue from death, deliverance from death. Now, those two things mark out the Christian gospel. First of all, the gift of God's forgiveness, the wonderful cleansing and renewal. We don't have to try to establish our own righteousness because we can't. It is a gift to us through the holiness of Jesus Christ. We're cleansed, if you like. We're released from our failures. It's been given us in Jesus Christ. He's called us to a holy life, and he's going to raise us from death. Raise us from death. He has brought life and immortality to light through the gospel. This is the great thing that God gives us, and we should treasure this message. The other thing about that makes the Christian gospel so powerful is that it does change people. Verse 9, he has called us to a holy life. The Christian gospel has proven itself a powerful instrument or force for lifting people out of the gutter, if you like, and transforming human nature. I haven't got time to elucidate it now, but history testifies to it, and that's what it calls us to. It brings holiness. We're called to a holy life. Therefore, as Christians and as Christian leaders particularly, we are called guardians of a priceless and great treasure. And we must not keep the treasure to ourselves. He says here in verse 13 and 14, what you have heard from me, keep as the pattern of sound teaching with faith and love in Christ Jesus. Guard the good deposit that was entrusted to you. Guard it with the help of the Holy Spirit who has been given to you. We preserve the good news by not keeping it to ourselves. Let me just repeat that. If you want to preserve the Christian faith, you must not keep it to yourself, but you must pass it on. Share it with others. Pass it on. That's what we're here to do. It's a very mistake to think the Christian church is for Christians. The Christian faith is for us, and we can just keep it to ourselves and not bother anyone else about it. Now, Paul says that he'd been appointed a herald, and an apostle, and a teacher. And those three words sum up, really, if you like, the communication of the Christian faith. Proclaiming, giving the news to telling people. We just have to pass the news on. What's the news we ought to pass on? That God loves us and has shown his love for us in Jesus Christ. And that we are to plant the Christian faith where it has not been before. This is the apostolic gift. If you like, in our terms, what we might call church planting. And we are to teach, explain, so people can understand the ways of God and live in that way. I met a lady a few weeks ago, an older lady, and she said to me, "Oh, I no longer believe in God." And I said to her, "Well, I've got some good news for you. God has not given up believing in you, ma'am. And he sent his son Jesus to die for your sins." Can I ask you, as you listen to this and watch this video and look at this passage with me, Can you sum up the Christian message in a brief way if you have a passing conversation with someone? Every Christian should be able to say something for Christ and convey the Christian message. The second reason Paul gives Timothy is that to be encouraged is that God will look after his message. It's his message after all, not ours. And he says this in verse 12. I know whom I have believed, and I am convinced that he is able to guard what I have entrusted to him until that day. God will look after his gospel. Now, there will be real problems, and there have been suffering thrown in and thrown against the church and the servants of the gospel. We'll face opposition sometimes, and sometimes, I think it's worse, we'll face apathy. I have to say, give me opposition anytime. Apathy is completely horrible to deal with. The why bother attitude. But Paul is confident that God will protect the gospel of salvation. Why? Because he knows God's character. God is faithful to his promises. I know him in whom I have believed. He is a faithful God. And also he says quite specifically that God has been planning this whole thing from before the beginning of time. Verse 9. This grace was given us in Christ Jesus before the beginning of time. This is not some passing thing. This was in the mind and plan of God before the universe was made. Let's be clear about that. God knows the future. He knows the difficulties. He knows what's happening. He's never caught by surprise by the problems. We might be, but he isn't. And we know that the power of God also will help us as we suffer for the gospel. Paul says that in verse 8. So do not be ashamed or testify about our Lord or of me, his prisoner. Rather, join with me in suffering for the gospel by the power of God. This is why he says in verse 12, I am suffering as I am. Suffering, is not pleasant, suffering for the gospel is actually part of the way we bear witness to the gospel. It's not some big setback for the Christian gospel. It was foreseen. And notice what Paul says. Join with me in suffering for the gospel by the power of God. And that means that the Holy Spirit will help us to defend the gospel. We should always pray for the anointing of the Holy Spirit. A third reason, St. Paul says here, for having confidence in our guardianship of the good news, we must hand it on unchanged. That's what we must do. That's our job. Hand the message on unchanged. That's our job. We're called to guard it and hand it on. Our calling as church leaders is to explain and to teach and hand the message on, but not to change it. Now, the itch to change the Bible and the Christian faith has been with the church from the beginning. And it ain't going away soon, can I just put it that way? The church in Ephesus had been troubled by false teachers. Right from that early generation, people were trying to kind of tweak the message and make it more palatable or more understandable to the people of their age. And we still have these people in the church. They occupy offices of authority, and they are usually very sincere, intelligent people. Don't get me wrong. The false teachers in the church are not necessarily always scurrilous people. Sometimes they are well-meaning, but well-meaning can be still go along with completely wrong. So we are called to guard the gospel and hand it on. He says here in verse 13, what you've heard from me, keep as the pattern of sound teaching with faith and love in Christ Jesus. Guard it. Keep it. When I was ordained as a priest in the Anglican Church of Australia, I had made a solemn vow that I would keep and pass on the faith that I'd received. In fact, I had to make a promise that when I saw that faith being contradicted and falsely taught, that I would not be quiet, but would stand up and say something about it. Because false teaching flourishes not only when people support it, but when other people who know it's wrong say nothing and let it pass. Silence is taken as consent, And people think, oh, this is the new version of Christianity now. No one spoke about it. The revisers have been doing their job. Now, I think different eras in the history of church and in different cultures have different heresies, different temptations. We have our own in the Western world at the moment, coming from the thinking of our age, but the thinking of our age gets in the church just like osmosis, if you like. It gets in. And Timothy may have been daunted and by the problems that he had, but we're not authorized to change the gospel. And I've said on more than one occasion to people, look, this is not my message. I didn't make it up. I'm just telling you about it. If you don't like it, you don't like it, but I didn't make it up. Don't blame me. I'm just telling you about it. The fourth reason to be encouraged in handing on the gospel and guarding it is we have the help of God to do it. We have the help of the Holy Spirit. We are to do this, he says, with faith and love in Christ Jesus. 13 and 14. Guard the gospel, good deposit, guard it with the help of the Holy Spirit who lives in us. Verse 13, with faith and love in Christ Jesus. Do you see there the appeal to the power of God? God will help us, and he will come alongside us and help us. Now, I go back to the verse I mentioned at the beginning. What God has given us is this triple equipment. This is what he provides. Power, love, and a sound mind. When the faith and love and the anointing of the Holy Spirit is on the church and on us as Christian people to defend the faith, it will manifest in people that are people with power, with love, and a sound mind. Let me take them in reverse order as I bring this to a close. First of all, a sound mind. This is self-discipline. This is wisdom. This is balanced thinking. This is good use of our reason. This is being able to outthink the critics and the heretics, to be able to put our finger on, here is the deeper issue where you've gone, taken a wrong turning. Remember, false teaching in the church is often originated from well-meaning, struggling with issues that are not easy to understand, or an attempt to make the faith communicable. But we need to be able to say to them, friend, you have taken a wrong turning, and here I put my finger on the mistake that you have made, and here is why it is a mistake. It's said that the ancient church fathers in the early centuries of the church, in their defending the faith in the pagan world, outthought their opponents, and that's what we need to do. We need to be able to say, I'm sorry, our Christian thinking shows us that this is wrong. So do you have a Christian mind? Do you exercise your thinking about what's going on? Don't just say there, oh, well, that might, I hear what he says, I'll just listen to it and just agree to it. Apply your mind to it. Test the truth. See what makes sense. Think it through. Remember, if you don't do that, if you and I don't do that, we will be shaped by the age, because we are being catechized by the television and the media and the movies and the television shows and the news narratives that are on the news. We are being constantly propagandized into a worldview. If you doubt me on this, just sit back and think about the message that's coming through. You watch a show, what's the message that's coming through? What's the view of life that's coming through? What's the view of ethics? What's the view of human nature coming through? What's the view about God that's coming through? And you will know you are getting a mindset coming through. The only way we'll deal with this is if we have a strong and discerning Christian mind. And secondly, love. We will need a life and heart filled with love for God and love for Jesus our Savior. Now, when we love Jesus, we will love people, and we want to love the lost people. We will live in love for people. That'll be our motivation. St. Paul said elsewhere to the Corinthians in 2 Corinthians 5, for the love of Christ compels us. We will have a great heart of love. In other words, when people are angry with us and people dislike us, we will love them back. We won't agree with them. We may challenge them back, but we will not be unpleasant or argumentative or rude to them. That's a lesson for all of us. And then, of course, finally, power. Here we get to the divine power in us. Power, love, and a sound mind. This is a mysterious enabling of God that comes along inside us and anoints what we do. This is the God of miracles, God who answers by fire, as we heard, think about the days of Elijah, the prophet of old. This is the amazing confidence and power that God gives. Sometimes it shows up in the humblest people. The ancient church and the martyrs showed that. So there it is. So we use our minds. We have our hearts filled with love for God, and we will be dependent on our knees for the Lord to supply us. So this is what God will do, and this is what we need. We don't have to be intimidated. And what we need to do is to fan into flame the gift and calling we have. Don't let that love for God go out. Don't let that passion to know God better go out. Kindle the flame. Fan into flame the gift of God, Paul says, which is in you through the laying on of my hands. One of my favorite hymns is the old hymn by Charles Wesley. Here are the first couple of stanzas. O thou who camest from above, the pure celestial fire to impart, kindle a flame of sacred love on the mean altar of my heart. There let it for thy glory burn with inextinguishable blaze, and trembling to its source return in humble prayer and fervent praise. May God bless each one of us as we give our witness in our own day. Let our little light shine, as it were, for the gospel of Jesus Christ. May the God of peace, who brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus, the great shepherd of the sheep, through the blood of the everlasting covenant, make you perfect in every good work to do his will, working in you what is pleasing in his sight. And the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen. Go in peace, filled with the power of the Holy Spirit. In the name of Christ. Amen. Thank you. Thank you for watching this video. We hope it's been of encouragement to you for your spiritual life. If you'd like what we produce here, please subscribe to this channel. That'll be a great help to our ministry. And if you want to support us financially via donation, you can do so in the link below this video, and that donation goes through our website. Thank you for watching again, and we pray that you'll be encouraged in your understanding and knowledge of God. So thank you very much for being with us.